trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry.
Happy New Year, everybody. You know, one of the things about the New Year that I often hear is, what resolution have you made? And then shortly thereafter, I hear that the resolutions have been broken. Well, I thought today I'd have three special guests who are coaches in the fields of eating. They are experts in the field of working out and also in the field of having less stress and learning how to be the best that we can be. So today I have the privilege of having Margaret Marchalon, who is the expert in the field of eating, and she's going to talk to us about that. Should we even make a resolution? And what about David E. Blumen? David is known in the field of reality, personal training. He's going to share with us different techniques that we can use, and even explain how we can find the perfect coach. And Eileen Lichtenstein, everyone knows of her, because they know all about her mind, her connection, her trying to make us the best that we can be. So when we come back, we're going to find out what Margaret Marshall's been up to. Be right back.
Welcome to Formula Auto Wash, where every day is a great day for a car wash. Open 7 days a week from 8 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. Sundays, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. Detailing packages for every budget, starting out at $29.99. 100% hand wash and detail center. Hogs hair and microfiber brushes and mitts. Proudly using Ecolab Blue Coral soaps and waxes. Formula Auto Wash has served the community for over 30 years. Senior discounts all day, every day. Ladies Day Wednesday, $3 off any wash. Early bird discount Monday through Thursday till 9:30 a.m. Check out our website, formulaautowash.com.
Thank you.
Welcome back, Margaret Marshall. So delighted to have you here.
Hi, Gail.
By popular demand.
Oh, thank you.
You made quite a few friends last time you won.
Thank you.
Of course, we do want to discuss your book, and we want to discuss all the things you've been doing. But I do want to mention that you're also helping people who have had cancer in their treatment and eating.
Right.
You know I'm so involved in that, so please share with
us. I know you are, and I know you have personal history with that.
Yes, yes.
And thankfully I don't, but you know, I work with many clients, and many of my clients have had cancer. I don't have cancer in my family, so we're very lucky about
that.
Thank
goodness.
Thank goodness is right. But I've had some clients, I've lost some clients to cancer, where I worked with them. You know, sometimes being overweight, the lifestyle that leads to being overweight can affect getting cancer. I don't know how else to say it.
Right.
So I've had clients with pancreatic cancer, breast cancer, lung cancer, and I've worked with them through their treatments to help them nourish their body as they're going through the treatments.
Very important. My husband had pancreatic cancer, and one of the biggest issues was getting that nutrition into
right.
him. When his stomach felt bloated and he really didn't want to
eat. And they don't want to eat,
so
and they have that taste in their mouth.
Correct. So I have to applaud you for that. And I also know that you're working with people who are giving up smoking. And one of the first worries that a person has who gives up smoking, though I'm not a smoker, is the fact that I will gain weight.
Right.
That's what I'm hearing.
Right.
So tell me a little bit about
that,
please.
Well, I do a program, and I do it in many corporations, Stop Smoking Without Weight Gain. So it's a smoking cessation program. But one of the major concerns, as you said, people who smoke, they're so afraid of gaining weight.
Right.
So I have this four-step program that I work with in corporations and people, and I have done it with private clients as well. And so we walk them through it, and you realize that losing weight at that time is not critical.
Correct.
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about
right.
it. Let's get rid of the smoking. Let's get that out of your life.
Mm-hmm.
Let's get you feeling good again.
Good.
Because someone who smokes, I don't even think they know how to feel good.
No, and then, the taste buds are off.
Oh, the taste buds wake up. And
you know, that's what I love about your entire program. You take a very practical, no-nonsense approach. You are responsible for what
yes.
you're doing, but you ease somebody into it. It's not that, oh my gosh, I got on the scale and I'm suddenly 20 pounds overweight.
Right.
This is something that is ongoing, and it's something that you treat. Let me ask you this. We talked before, I mentioned resolutions. Do you feel that people should make resolutions?
Well, you know, you hear all the experts on the radio and the television now saying,
right.
don't make resolutions.
Don't do it.
I don't know why they say that, because I do believe people should make resolutions. But when you make a resolution, there's a desire behind that resolution.
Right.
So if
right.
you can get to that desire and know what that desire is.
So
if your resolution is to lose weight, what's the desire behind that? Is it to feel better? Is it to look better? Is it to, you know, come off medications? And then make it a daily ritual.
Ritual, okay. And it almost sounds like you're saying goal. I'm hearing your goal.
Whatever word you want to use.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I think that may be better than the resolution. People say, I'll make resolutions, and then they're suddenly broken, and then they give up.
Right, but I think their resolutions are broad.
Broad, okay.
You have to bring it back in and know what's behind it.
Okay.
Know what's behind it.
Now, I know some of the words are verboten in your vocabulary, and I know one of them is the word diet, and the other word is the F word.
My F word.
Fat, the F word.
My
so
F word.
Tell me a little
you know,
bit
I have
about
a different
that.
Opinion on both of those
okay.
words, so let's do the F word first.
Sure.
I have been in this business for, it's 27 years now, I've been helping people get to an ideal body weight in a very healthy manner, and one of the things that people that I find clients or people, they call themselves fat. And once they call themselves fat, they believe that. And I hate to even say that word. I have two children. When my children were young, I used to say to them, fat is the F word. We never say that at anybody.
It's like a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Oh, it certainly is.
Is that what you're saying?
Right. So, you know, wordings are different for everybody, but I always feel that if you're overweight, you can shed the overweight. But once you believe that you're that F word,
you will stay that word.
It stays in your mind.
Right.
And then
it
comes back.
And what about the word diet?
The word diet, I personally do not have a problem with. Diet means the way you eat.
Okay.
And in my book, you'll see that I have an acronym for the word diet.
Right.
And so the D-I-E-T, the word diet is decide how I'll eat today, D-I-E-T. And when you take the control to make those decisions for yourself, what foods you're going to eat, every food you eat has a benefit or consequence to you. And you just have to be willing to accept the benefit.
You know what's good about this, too, is that you're giving the person control. There are many people get on the scale, look in the mirror, start to panic at the way they look, and they think that they have no control. What I'm hearing you say is that the person does have control. You're responsible for your actions, and if it's a positive, great. And if it's a negative because you are doing it, understand it. Is that correct?
Whatever weight you're at today,
right,
you made it happen.
I tell you, with this book, and you laugh, but I highlighted the book. I went through the book. I love it. But I do think that one needs to go through the book a few times in order to really understand all the information. I like the idea of going through it quickly, then going back and really highlighting the parts that pertain to you. The part that I especially enjoyed was when you said in the chapter, eat anything but not everything.
Right.
And
right.
You numbered different types
right.
of food.
Right. I have a rating system that I use with my clients, and it's look at the food that's available to you and rate it from 1 to 10.
Right.
And then eat your 8, 9s, and 10s. Anything that's under an 8 to you is mediocre. So you don't really need it. So look for the foods that you really love and then learn how to eat them.
Yeah, don't deprive yourself because you're going to keep thinking about that.
Right.
And the other aspect of that chapter too was don't think about what I'm not going to eat, but rather about what I'm going to eat.
Right.
Your goobers?
Oh, my goober story. My goober story in the book. But the theory is that when I was younger and I was trying to lose my own weight, I would take my kids to the movies, and I, the whole way there, I would think, I'm not going to have goobers, I'm not
right.
going to have goobers. And I'd get right to the movie theater each time and buy those goobers. And so what I realized is our brains do not register the word won't, can't. So really what I was saying, if you take that word out, not, I was really saying I'm going to have goobers.
Right.
I was really chanting what I was going to do. So I learned when I learned that and I realized that, I started thinking, driving my kids to the movies, same scenario. I'm going to have a cup of coffee. I'm going to have a cup of
coffee. And you went and had the coffee?
Effortlessly, it changed.
You know, you have to try that. It really does work.
It's amazing.
Now, I love my ice cream, and I'm known to consume a gallon of ice cream. And the other day, I tried that. I said, you've had enough sugar. It's not a question of weight with me, honestly.
Right, right.
But it's a question of eating properly. It
right.
was the sugar. And I started thinking, I'm not going to have ice cream. No more ice cream. Do you know the third commercial, watching one of the movies, I ran in and I had that ice cream. And I also thought, I'm not going to feel guilty about it. I had it. That's it.
Right.
So I totally agree with you. Now, let's go back to you having two young children. And you said yourself that you had gained some weight. And you started to even isolate yourself more within the home. You weren't putting on the makeup. You weren't getting dressed. How did that affect you and your weight?
Well, you know, when I lost my weight, I went from a size 16 to a size 10 when I was 30 years old. Mm. And I spent most of my life, I was an overweight child, and my nickname was Margaret the Big Fat Target.
Oh.
And I could laugh at it now, but I didn't then, certainly.
No, that's not.
And so by the time I was 30 and I yo-yo dieted mm-hmm. all my life and did really unhealthy things. And in writing the book, I thought to myself, did I have an undiagnosed eating disorder? I don't know.
Hmm.
I don't know. But anyway, regardless, I wasn't really taking care of myself.
Right.
You know, I was a mother of two small children at the
mm-hmm.
time,
mm-hmm.
and I really was not taking care of myself. I just wore whatever fit and, you know, didn't put makeup on, didn't care what my hair looked like. I wore sneakers And when I started taking care of myself, I realized, first thing in the morning, get up, get dressed,
absolutely.
Do your hair, put your makeup on, and put jewelry on.
People tease me because I got to empty the garbage and I'm all dressed. But there's a mindset.
Oh, such
and
wisdom.
A word that we're going to hear later from Eileen as well that you use is this mindfulness.
Mindfulness.
And there's this mindset to get out there, to be the best you can be. I also love the fact that you state, Margaret, that we should love our bodies at any stage or any weight that we're in.
Correct.
Why is that so important?
I think when you have to learn to love your body regardless of your weight, because that's when you'll take care of it.
Okay.
If you're not loving your body, you're abusing
right,
your body
right.
with something, smoking,
sure,
eating,
it could be
something. It could be illegal
anything.
Things. So
sure.
once you learn to love your body, your body gives you life
right.
and it brings you joy. You'll learn to care for it more. And this example I use with my clients all the time is when you buy furniture for your home, the furniture that you spend the most money on, you take better care
of. You take better care of.
If you buy something at a garage
right.
sale.
Right. You mentioned about being somewhat overweight as a child. And today, it just seems that so many more children have higher cholesterol, are more obese, I'm going to use that word. And I understand that there's more TV, more with the computer. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, you know, when a family calls me to come in and work with their young child, I don't do it unless I work with the entire family.
It's a family problem.
It is absolutely a family
problem.
Even if the other people in the family are not overweight, it is absolutely a family problem. And so it has to be a team effort. And lifestyles are very different now. Maybe children are home more. You know, they're not maybe as active.
We used to go outside, Margaret, and we'd play Ring-a-Leo and all kinds of things
went on.
Outside and come back in. And we have so much more to cover, so I'm going to ask you, too, also about college. What one suggestion could you think of to help our college kids so that they don't gain that college 20 that freshman year?
Okay, the one thing, and I'm going to do a segment on college eating coming up for another station, but the one thing I would say to college students, you're at college to start your career. You're at college to start your life. This is the game of life. In 4 years, you are going to be in an extremely competitive job market.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have the perception of health, you are already behind the eight ball. And if you spend the 4 years at college eating junk and drinking lots of alcohol and gaining weight, when it's time to start looking for that job, you're not I'm thinking effective, but that's not really what I want. With your competition. You know, there's a lot of competition out there, and you have to look your best.
I also would like to ask you a little bit about your holiday eating survival guide. I'm still entertaining friends over, good friends, actually, for movies the other night, and we're still eating. So just give me a couple of things. I know, for example, you should always see a little space on your plate. What are some other things?
Those three words, see your plate.
See
your plate. When you put your food on your plate, there should be valleys in between your food.
And that's pile it on.
Not just pile it on and pile it over, and that's automatic portion control. You know, from October to December, I do many seminars on the Holiday Eating Survival Guide. And so I have many tips. I know you have some written there.
I do. I know you say see your plate, hear your sigh, or maybe the sigh.
Breath.
Or maybe somebody else sighing around you.
Hear your breath. Listen to your breath. Once you start to breathe a little heavier, you had enough to eat. And it's funny, when you do start to be aware of that, you hear other people.
Everybody else. Yeah. You also say get rid of leftovers.
Yes.
If it were vegetables and fruits and they would start to go bad, you'd get rid of it.
Right.
And food, like cakes.
Well, what I say is they say they don't want to get rid of food. They don't want to throw food out. I can respect that, but what happens is you buy all these fruits and vegetables with good intentions, and then you have all the leftover cakes and cookies, and at the end of the week, you're throwing out the fruits and vegetables anyway.
You also
you're eating the cakes and cookies.
Watch your alcohol intake, and you're so correct in that, because it lowers inhibitions, and you start to even eat probably more food.
You eat more when you drink more, yes.
One question that's come up quite often is that people many times reward you with food, or they think they're loving you with food. How do you politely rescind the offer of food? How do you say, no, thank you?
Well, food is love.
Yes.
Food is love. And I have a whole story about that, one of my clients in my book. But food is love. What I have learned and what I teach my clients to say is, oh, thank you. Maybe later.
I love that.
But don't say no.
No, because
don't
that's a rejection.
Even though in the book it does say no, I think the editor changed that and I didn't catch it.
No, it was, it's
did
changed.
It say, oh,
you don't have to say no.
Don't have
Absolutely.
To say no, because no is throwing their love back
their
at
face.
Them.
Right,
so you just say, thank you.
Let me ask you this. Why should we forget about motivation and willpower?
I'm not a fan of the word willpower.
Okay.
I think that's putting the power into something else. Mm-hmm. And when people use the word willpower, it's never in a positive tone.
Correct.
It's always, I have no willpower.
Right.
It's so it's an empowerment from yourself. So instead of putting the power in Will, put the power in Margaret.
Okay.
Put the power in whoever.
Empower yourself.
Empower yourself.
Empower yourself. Now, we have like a minute to wrap this up, but when you go to eat out, one of the things that we'll do is we'll share the food.
Okay.
We'll take some of the food, because I do find I'm more interested in the person I'm with than I actually am with the meal.
Right.
So that's a good suggestion. And I saw some of your other suggestions as well. Don't go hungry.
Right.
Drink water.
Right.
Socialize. One question, though, I do have to ask you before we wrap it up is, when you're in the supermarket, you walk in, what's the first thing? The wafting of the smell of bakery
goods. The bakery.
The colors. How does one prepare for that without buying everything that you don't even want?
Okay. You know, the supermarket is a minefield. And it was once, if you walked the perimeter, you were buying all the healthy food. But they got wise to us. So now they put the bakery
right, in the
right as you walk in. The
right
deli
in the
counter, the beer, the diet foods that make us heavier, the snack foods. And they're all around the perimeter now. So you have to really be careful. I say to people, leave your cart at the end of the aisle, walk down the aisle, get what you need, because you can only get what you can carry, and then walk back to your cart.
Terrific. I want to thank you so much. We're going to have you come back again, because we're still so much more. When we come back, I'm going to be exercising with David E. Blumen. But first, we're going to hear all about his new programs. We'll be right back.
YesWeCare.net is a 501c3 charity that provides help to veterans and their families. Please visit YesWeCare.net and donate in any way you can by purchasing our beautiful frame prints or relaxation CDs and DVDs, even smooth jazz CDs. YesWeCare.net. Remember, our troops are on their way home. They need all the support they can get. YesWeCare.net.
Hi, my name is Dr. Tom Dow. We have a multidiscipline practice in Melville and Ronkonkoma, New York, and we treat patients with many, many different conditions, from newborns through geriatric patients with numerous different techniques. There's a technique and a type of treatment for every class of patient. We have them all here. Here's my son Thomas, also a doctor of chiropractic, working on one of our patients' cervical spine. This patient has had chronic neck pain for many, many, many years, has been to a multitude of different practitioners with little or no response. And with our specialized techniques, she has improved tremendously and continues to improve on a daily basis. We have two practices, one in Melville and one in Ronkonkoma, New York. We are a multidiscipline chiropractic office. What that means is we have chiropractors, massage therapists, acupuncturists, psychologists, all working as a team and a network of outside professionals such as orthopedists and neurologists that we work hand in hand with to help determine what your injuries are and the best way to treat your injuries. I have the great pleasure of having my son in practice with me. We work hand in hand, father and son, to give our patients the best care possible and a staff which is loving, caring, and you'll never have to wait at all in our office for service. Many times patients come into our office and they have what's called a soft tissue injury. Soft tissue injuries are like scars inside your body. If you've ever been cut on the outside of your body, you get a scar. The same thing happens inside of your body to your muscles and ligaments. So our job is to determine where those are, stretch the muscles, adjust the vertebra back into their correct position, and then refortify the normal structure with exercise.
That's what we do best,
and I hope someday you'll come see us at one of our two offices. Thank you.
For professional motorcycle transport and towing, think Kickstart Fabrications Motorcycle Towing. Proudly serving all of Long Island, we feature expert handling and 24/7 service. So send a limo for your toy with Kickstart Fabrications Motorcycle Towing.
Welcome to Formula Auto Wash, where every day is a great day for a car wash. Open 7 days a week from 8 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. Sundays, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. Detailing packages for every budget, starting out at $29.99. 100% hand wash and detail center. Hogs hair and microfiber brushes and mitts. Proudly using Ecolab Blue Coral soaps and waxes. Formula Auto Wash has served the community for over 30 years. Senior discounts all day, every day. Ladies Day Wednesday.
I just got to check the clock. Welcome, David E. Bloman. I am so happy to have you here. As you can see, I'm just about ready for whatever. Okay, you are a certified personal trainer. You've done group training. You have your reality
personal training trainer. Is my business, right?
You have two black belts. I'm quite impressed. You've worked in Pilates, kickboxing. You've trained people. Have gone on to get all kinds of awards, though I know you're very modest about it.
Thank you.
But I do have to ask you, who inspired you and how did you end up here?
My first knee injury in college was what inspired me when I started going for physical therapy. And then I had a roommate who was avid into working out when I was in college. And I just kind of took it from that point on and realized I wanted to help other people. And that's where I started to move into the personal training industry.
Wow, okay. Now, I also wanted to ask you about your using martial arts and fitness training to help people who have attention deficit disorder. I had never heard this before.
Well, martial arts gives you a lot of discipline and a lot of focus. You're in an environment where you want to conform to what's happening with you. And part of the attention deficit is not having a focal point. So you tend to follow the instructor, follow the class, and then you start to develop self-discipline from that. So first you have the external discipline of the instructor and the
that
class.
Makes so much sense.
And then you have the internal discipline of doing this repetitively.
In a few weeks, I'm going to have someone talking about body disorders, bulimia. Now, I understand that you have also worked with people who have difficulty with that. Is it the same type of reasoning, the discipline?
Well, in this case, a lot of that has to do more with their confidence and their self-image. And part of the martial arts, and even in fitness training now, too, it's taking the small pieces and putting them together and having small successes. You know, we would go through each belt rank, but through each belt rank, we would give them little marks on their belt, like you're one stripe, you're two stripe, you're three, and then you would test to move on to the next thing. So we took everything in small bits, which kind of is really what we were talking about with resolutions and being more goal-oriented rather than
as opposed to making
resolutions and, you know, flying off and going, yeah, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that.
No,
and,
but when you're goal-oriented, you can see it. You can measure it, and it's something that can keep improving.
Right.
And you do need that praise. We need it in all fields, but I can definitely see it here.
Yeah, and particularly with eating disorder.
Now, you also do different programs, and you gear it to different ages. Mm-hmm. And I know that you have so many different tools and different methods and techniques. One of them I'm interested in, and I guess it's because I have grandchildren that age, the 3 to 5 year olds.
Well, the three to five year old programs that we did were really to, particularly in the martial arts, but even in fitness? It's okay. Just to get them moving. It's to give them a basis to build them to move towards, whether it's in the fitness arena towards sports or in the martial arts. It was to prepare them to go into the regular program. And so we had to, you know, be creative and engaging, make sure we were working within their attention span, understanding their physiology and their response to exercise. So there was a lot that went into that, but it's so beneficial because it turns into a...
Too. I'm sorry, right, is that a lot of young kids, when they get into the exercise programs, they do much better in school. Are you hearing that as well?
Absolutely, and that was something, you know,
one
of the schools I worked with, which sold off a long time ago, but I'm still very close with the instructor, Mark Glazier, mm-hmm. and my own sensei, Roger Dabney, in Virginia, and they still run, you know, better grades guaranteed programs,
right.
Like they would advertise
right.
for that, but it's true, because everything that they learn in that discipline and the small goals and all those bits carry over. It's the same thing with fitness.
Right.
You know, you have to remember, you're moving, you're bringing more oxygen to your brain, you have more focus,
right.
you're able to relax more as well, so it really carries into the classroom.
What are some of the biggest mistakes people make in the gym and get hurt or injured, and what would you say?
Well, I would have to say across the board right now, it's really looking at things you're seeing being done on YouTube and then trying to
emulate them. That's somebody there.
Going into very high movements that require a lot of complexity, and then again trying to do those in certain, and I don't want to say any names about certain facilities because not all like that.
But
when you're starting to do snatches and deadlifts and all of these complex movements,
right.
and no one's really teaching you the nuances of that. That's why I brought the kettlebells today, because I really want to break one movement down with you today, which is something that's been very, very popular.
Right. I have to tell you that in one of the classes I took, and it's so funny that they were talking about kick your leg up higher. It was kickboxing.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know why I kept thinking that the instructor was talking to me when there were 25 people in there. But I kicked that leg up higher and higher. I tore my rotator cuff. I ended up on my backside. And I thought, is that as high as I can get that leg up there?
Well,
but again, you do have to be careful with this. How do you find the right trainer for you? That's a good question.
I want to just touch on what happened to you in class, because this is something that's pervasive in the industry. And that's the cueing and the coaching and being able to recognize someone's level.
Right.
So it is about finding when you find the right instructor, whether it's in a group, a small group, or a one-on-one setting, it's really working within the confines of your ability to move right now. And then progressing you and or being able to regress you in that setting.
Yes.
So that although the person next to you has been doing the class for, you know, 20 times and the coach is saying, go kick your leg higher. And then, like I said, you end up on your tush. It becomes a danger.
Now that you mention that, you know, why is your training, your gym, if you will, different from others?
Well, first of all, I don't have a facility,
gym.
Right?
Correct.
I come to my clients. Some of them have home gyms.
Correct.
Some of them have gyms in their building.
Mm-hmm.
But it's about individualizing, and you'll find many of the professionals that I work with look at you as an individual. Listen, I'm going to use mainly the same exercises.
Sure.
I'm going to program them and progress you based on what you're able to do. You know, yes, is a squat going to be a high metabolic exercise? Absolutely.
Right.
Do when I start putting a load on you with it, putting resistance on
you
is something.
You have to know your client.
Need to know that I have built the foundation for you to do that first. And that's something I look at, because you were asking me earlier about one of the programs. I'm going to throw a little plug out here. My friend Dave's going to have an excitement because I did this on TV for him. But the Kettlebell Concepts, I'm one of the senior instructors. And we use what we call our MMM. It's mind, movement, and muscle.
Mind, movement, and muscle.
And basically, it's we're effectively creating movement from the brain and then working all the way through the movement, because that's what we do regularly. It's not individualizing
it's
like
not.
A single movement.
Right. You're
but
putting
moving,
everything
like I said,
together.
In a complex pattern, and then enacting the muscles that are necessary in the proper way.
I'm glad that you said that about movement, because I know that you're working on a program about healing through movement. But before we get into that, I have to ask you this. Okay, here we go. You said you can see the neurological, big words here, landscape of my body as I just stand still?
Well,
first of all, what does that mean? And secondly, why is that important?
Well, simply, I could tell when I first met you, and this is because of my sisters particularly, but from being in the field and developing, like, I try to call it the coach's eye. I mean, that's really the easiest thing, is I could see the way that you stand,
right.
I could see the way you shift,
mm-hmm.
how you position your feet, where your hip
Bellators.
Is. Right, well, that's it. And that's
for,
right, and even dancers have the tendency to continue to walk that way, and it does create a stress. It's not how
right.
we were designed
right.
to move
right.
in everyday
right.
life. And that's what, you know, we talk about activities of daily living, even simply walking.
I had to learn how there's to a model.
So like I look from head to toe for your alignment, basically.
Okay, so it's really my alignment. It's how I'm shifting my weight, my position,
your posture,
where I'm coming from, the posture that I have.
I always make
okay,
a joke.
Okay, now let's talk about this healing power. This is very dear to you, and I know that you've worked on this with Lisa Hoffman.
Yes.
But I do want to ask you about your mom and your grandma, and then I'd like to do a few of the exercises, if we can.
Okay. Well, I'm going to, like I said, I'm going to, since it's the new year, I'm going to take you through some simple exercises, basic movements that are not necessarily geared to this program. They're more progressive.
Okay.
But my mom is a breast cancer survivor.
Right.
My grandmother survived two mastectomies when she probably shouldn't have in the years that she had them, and she was just an amazing, amazing survivor. And last year, post-hurricane, I was doing some, I was doing a lot of relief work, I was doing a lot of volunteering, and Lisa Hoffman reached out to me with her program. It's the PACT program,
PACT
which
program.
Is physical activity
Excellent.
During cancer training, and she says, you are the guy I want to work with bringing this to the masses in our field. And she put this together because of the healing power of exercise.
That. Love that.
And that's really...
I want to thank you for that because, you know, after treatment, during treatment with the edema, the swelling, the surgery. So what are you going to do with me?
Okay. Well, I'm going to teach you how to swing a kettlebell because this is a very, very big movement. So I'm going to work a little bit backwards with you here. So the first
okay.
thing I want you to do is take the kettlebell, bring it between your feet.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm going to watch you as you squat. So I want you to do a good squat. Pick up the kettlebell in two hands. Okay, keep your chest up. Right. And your top on. Sorry, a little bit of humor has to go there. Now, the kettlebell swing is built on what's called a Romanian deadlift. It's a slightly bent-kneed movement. Now, so you're doing your total dance. You're like in plié position. So I want you to get your toes, your knees, your
everything
hips.
Everything in alignment?
Right. Everything in alignment. Now, I'm just going to come coach you
oh,
for a
okay.
second. All right, so we can do that. This is what we were talking about before, how we see you move. Now you can put your feet a little wider, but keep those toes towards me. Now, stick your tush back this way. That's it, chest stays up, and now just sit a little bit. And now all I want you to do is like you're picking up a box from in front of you, and your eyes here, and just lean over slightly.
Yeah, make it feel
better. Now, right, that's it, now a little, just a little. Your hair's covering everything, don't worry. Okay, so now I want you to come up and remember Wayne's World to get a little swing, okay? And then we're going to do the same thing I'm going to do together.
Okay. Okay,
so we're going to come down here first. So you're pushing like you're pushing your rear end towards the chair and the
oh,
wall.
Oh, it's hitting the chair.
Oh, yeah. And make sure you're feeling it back there.
I'm feeling
okay, now
it.
I want you to come halfway, and I want you to just let the kettlebell pendulum a little bit. Okay, so now everything is going to happen from the hip. Your arms are like when you're a little kid, and you're just letting them swing.
Let it go. Let
so
it
now
go.
I just want you to thrust the hip and let the kettlebell and let it go right back between your hips and just rock. You know, like I said,
what?
Just look
what?
At this, and we're right in
and
sync.
What am I doing this
I see
for?
Us on camera. We're in sync. Good, now snap your hips a little harder and a little faster and
Please
get it right up in front of your chin.
Whoa!
Good, now let it go back. Let it swing back right behind your
toe.
Good. Now just let it dissipate.
Dissipate, okay.
Okay, now chest back up
chest
and
back
give
up.
Me a good squat.
Okay, now why did I do that? What does that do?
Okay, what we just worked on is your entire posterior chain, okay? Every woman wants to work their hamstrings and their tush, but this goes all the way up.
Oh, I can just see it coming out already.
Yeah. This works all the way up into your whole thoracic spine.
I felt that. I
because
did.
You're hinging at the hip.
Okay.
So you're stabilizing the entire, and this is a big buzzword, but when I say the word core, I'm talking about three dimensions from your knee to your thoracic and cervical spine, right where it starts.
How is that
That's
different?
Your core.
Dave, how is that different than the core when I do Pilates?
Well, Pilates is very abdominal. Focused.
Right, I do.
There's not a lot of stuff happening with the hamstrings
okay.
and the glutes,
good,
which
good.
Is really, for me as a trainer, is one of the most important areas in the entire body because this is where my house is.
Right,
I got to build
right.
my house in my hips
right.
and here, and I want to prevent those low back injuries.
That low back, that's the big thing.
Okay, people think I do ab crunches.
I have a question for you.
But that's not
why
right.
Why is he out of breath and I'm not?
Because my kettlebell's 45 and I'm talking and speaking while we're doing it. And I have a mock turtleneck to look, you know, all dapper.
I love that. That was terrific. So now tell me more about your mom and grandma, how they're doing, what's going on.
Oh, my mom is awesome. I mean, she's great.
So
grandma
happy.
Passed several years ago, so, but close to 90. You know, she was
Look
in her
that.
Late.
That's
she was
fabulous.
87 or 88.
Okay, now to close, I have to ask you, what's next on the agenda for you? And I want to thank you so
okay.
much.
Okay, next on the agenda. Well, this obviously is a very busy year
yeah,
for me
yeah,
in
yeah.
in turn
we
this,
could sit
this
down.
Time of year. Okay, a very busy time of year for me, as far as training goes, and I have opened myself up to taking new clients on again. I had a very difficult time after the hurricane, so I've been in rebuilding
Long
mode.
Beach and,
but
oh,
I have my
goodness.
Own Train the Trainer event.
Right.
Which is from my company, the Fitness Education Institute, the FEI Eclipse. This is our third annual event. I survived the hurricane and had my second,
wow.
so that's very exciting. I will
and your clients love you. If you go on your website,
you
know, which is posted, it's amazing the testimonials that people give because you do individualize, because you make it fun. And people want that as well.
I had a client for 9 years.
Unbelievable.
I have a very
well,
high retention rate.
I want
rate.
To thank you so much. And when we come back, we're going to meet with Eileen Lichtenstein, who's going to talk to us about getting rid of stress and also about what's called tapping, EFT program. Right back. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
When your cable's on the fritz, you get frustrated. When you get frustrated, your daughter imitates. When your daughter imitates, she gets thrown out of school. When she gets thrown out of school, she meets undesirables. When she meets undesirables, she ties the knot with undesirables. And when she ties the knot with undesirables, you get a grandson with a dog collar. Don't have a grandson with a dog collar. Get rid of cable and upgrade to DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV. When your cable company keeps you on hold, you get angry. When you get angry, you go blow off steam. When you go blow off steam, accidents happen. When accidents happen, you get an eye patch. When you get an eye patch, people think you're tough. When people think you're tough, people want to see how tough. And when people want to see how tough, you wake up in a roadside ditch. Don't wake up in a roadside ditch. Get rid of cable and upgrade to DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV. When you pay too much for cable, you throw things. When you throw things, people think you have anger issues. When people think you have anger issues, your schedule clears up. When your schedule clears up, you grow a scraggly beard. When you grow a scraggly beard, you start taking in stray animals. And when you start taking in stray animals, you can't stop taking in stray animals. Stop taking in stray animals. Get rid of cable and upgrade to DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
For professional motorcycle transport and towing, think Kickstart Fabrications Motorcycle Towing. Proudly serving all of Long Island, we feature expert handling and 24/7 service. So send a limo for your toy with Kickstart Fabrications Motorcycle Towing.
Welcome back, and I didn't change because I want to give you more time to speak because you have so many incredible programs. This is Eileen Lichtenstein, and she's a peak performance success coach, certified life and career coach, anger management specialist, and also does advanced work in EFT, which we're going to hear about in a few minutes. Welcome to the show, and I am so excited about your work that you sent me, which is your interactive Soar with Resilience. I love an interactive book because, again, I can only take my time, but I can see if I'm truly understanding it. And I worked a little bit from some of the exercises that you were kind enough to send me. When people get information from you, Eileen, how do they reach you? How do they get this information?
I'm very accessible on the web and by telephone. You can call me anytime, of course, I won't answer all the time, but you can leave me a message. And that number is 516-623-4353. I always give a complimentary phone consult. So whatever program you may be interested in, we could talk about it. And I can see you in Long Island in Massapequa Park office or via video Skype, which I love.
Excellent.
I have international clients, including my grandson. No, my grandson is like 6 months old. So that's how I learned video Skype, you know, originally.
So you have e-book.
I have the e-book. It's my program, Soar with Resilience.
Now, you have so many different programs, one of which that I have to look into because I could be a bit of a perfectionist. And although many people think that's wonderful, it's not always good because it can sometimes take the fun out of it. An example, don't watch my shows, but I listen to them because I'm a little bit self-conscious because I'm not perfect. What piece of advice, and I know that you spend 30 minutes to an hour going over the different workshops, but what piece of advice would you give someone like me to just...
Okay. Usually perfectionists wait until things are perfect. Mm-hmm. What your goals are, what your plan is, your game plan, everything has to be in perfect place, so to speak,
right. Before
you get started. And often that prevents you from getting started in a timely way. So
right. Sometimes
it is beneficial. You need to weigh which is more important, to get it perfect or to let a few little things go and get it started.
So is this the mindfulness that we talked about a little bit earlier?
Well, it's a mindset
that
can include mindfulness. What mindfulness means is really paying attention. And being kind of in tune to everything, including your breath, including how you're thinking, and everything around you. Mindfulness is a lot of awareness.
A lot of awareness. I love that word, to be aware of everything. Now, you have so many different programs. You have the sandwich.
Generations.
You want to mention a little bit about that?
For instance, you and I are of this generation.
We are.
And it's about taking care of elderly parents and
younger
either children or grandchildren or whoever it may be. And we're often pulled in many, many directions. So I've kind of honed these time and stress management skills and strategies to work with people with really busy lives,
right.
as most people in sandwich generations have.
Right, absolutely.
You know, so it's about staying in balance, not necessarily every piece of your life being equal,
right.
but about being able to literally stand on one foot without falling down, as in ballet.
Right.
And
so it's inner strength.
Yes.
And balance.
Yes.
And you're helping us to recognize it. And although some people may be in therapy, these are techniques that will help us.
That's right.
They're helping us to, you know, be more in tune with one another and to feel better. Some of the others, I do want to mention this because you work on anger management, which I hope that you'll come back and work on with me when we do some different programs. You have bullying, cyberbullying. You're talking about building stronger relationships, liking oneself better. You're talking about career reinvention. What piece of advice would you give someone in that field who is retired and maybe wants to get back out there? It's not what he thought it would be.
It's about being mindful and understanding what it is that you really, really like to do. And are you, for instance, a people person, or do you like to work with numbers more and technology more? That kind of thing. So understand where your passion is.
Okay, it's about your passion. I love that word. Mm-hmm. Now let's talk about, today I want to talk about two things, but I would like to get into this idea of stress. We know that stress can be good, stress can be bad. There's good stress, and I mentioned to you before, perhaps getting married, well, that could be good or bad. But usually good, having a new baby. And again, you know, this whole idea. And it affects your mind, your heart. It affects your behavior. So what are some techniques that you have that can help people going through a stressful time?
Okay, the techniques that I teach and I share with people have actually been around for centuries, and they've been kind of rebirthed back into the Western world with the whole movement of mindfulness that has become more and more popular. Thank goodness, as things become more chaotic, it's indicated that that people pay attention to what's going on. So in order to do that, the simple breathing, the relaxation breathing, or the diaphragmatic or yogic breathing, there's several names of it.
Could we try a little bit of breathing?
And the thing
is, like Lamaze, right?
It is almost like Lamaze. And I have to say, because I'm a dancer also, and in our dance training, and often young women, whether they're dancers or not, are told, suck in your belly, stand up, suck
stand
it
up, posture.
So that was always it, and that is the opposite of relaxing your belly when you breathe. So as you inhale, just let it all hang out. No one can tell. No one sees this. It's like a balloon filling up in your belly. And as you exhale, it slowly deflates.
And
children can learn this as well. It's very relaxing for them.
Very calming.
Anybody can help themselves to relax, and especially to go to sleep. And if you want to see if you're doing it properly, you could put one hand on your belly, one hand on your chest. Inhale through your nose if you can. And the belly comes up first, then the chest. And then you exhale, and the belly is the last thing to deflate. So in this way...
Oh, I love it. So you could do this at work. I mean, we all need to take some time wherever we are.
Absolutely.
And do this. You also mentioned for some of these stress busters, stretching. So what do you suggest there? Now I'm at work, and I need a few minutes.
Okay.
Need a break.
Well, several things are coming to mind. When at work, often we are stressed, and we want to relax, but it's like someone saying, just relax. It's like, ha, 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 right?
How do you do
it? Ha, ha, ha. So there's something called the progressive muscle relaxation, which is actually a stress reduction technique. And at the same time, it releases stress. Yes. So it can kind of prep your body to do some gentle stretching. And what it is you tense and you release muscles individually. You contract,
start at
the feet, inhale, and just tighten them up, and exhale, undo that however you want.
I like it.
And then inhale, put a squeeze on your calves like you're wearing high heels, and exhale, undo that.
Oh, I like that.
And then you come up to your quads around your knees,
I truly am.
Inhale, and you tighten that up, and you exhale and relax.
Exhale so it's a stress.
And you go all the way up. And then after that, you have a choice of either just going on a little mini vacation to wherever you
visualization.
Were. Exactly.
I mean, for me, it's by the water. Everybody has a different place.
You know, exactly.
Laughter is good. We want to hear jokes.
Laughter.
I do know that you mentioned, too, and we are going to be running out of time, so I want to mention this, that at work, if you find that there's some kind of crisis going on or there's tension, walk away.
Oh, yeah. That's rule number one.
Don't get into it. Refuse it. Stay away from the drama queens if you can. And sometimes it's difficult because I know people want to draw you in because they want to get your side, your opinion. Mm-hmm. And I think the best thing to do is just what?
Walk away.
Walk away.
Walk away.
And if you're going to lose your temper, walk away.
Absolutely.
Walk away.
And if you walk away and you find yourself very irritated or frustrated or verging on very angry, you can. You can go.
Okay.
Standing up or sitting down.
Right. It's again with the.
And it's part of that progressive muscle relaxation, but it's an isolation, just a punch. An imaginary person or thing. And
Now, Eileen, you know, only 8% of real worrying is based on real issues. 40% of it is never going to happen, right?
Right. These are statistics.
30% of it, you know, is something you can't control. And, of course, the 10% is medicinal and you shouldn't get stressed. So it's really, when you think about stress, only 8% of anything really going to happen. We only have a few minutes to get into tapping, so I do have to ask you to please explain this.
Okay. Real quick, tapping is EFT, which is emotional freedom technique, and you learn the places to tap by a practitioner, and there are also many things online with it. And you're tapping on meridian points, which are the same that is used in Eastern medicine and acupressure and so on. And what happens when you tap on these points is serotonin, which is a really feel-good chemical in the body, it
releases.
Goes to the part of the brain that deals with emotion, and it helps you feel good. It's also really good for the circulation.
Excellent.
Then, if a practitioner adds in your story, and I'm very intuitive, so if you tell me something, I get it even deeper, and I tell your story.
Number one fear, and I remember this from my students, everybody would say, was it dog bites, a phobia? Was it snakes? No, the number one fear was?
Public speaking.
So can you give us an example of how the person comes to you, and what would you
do? So I'd start with the karate chop point. Even though I'm so scared of to speak in front of the crowd, I fully and deeply love and accept myself. Even though I get sweaty and my heart races, I still fully and deeply love and accept myself. And we go on like this, and then we go into telling the story, and we go from negative to positive. And what happens eventually is we say things like, I can do it, I can do it, just do it. There are only people out there, I'm in control, I know what I'm saying, I'm really super prepared, and so on. So it becomes a storytelling that the practitioner leads, and the goal is for the coachee to be able to do this himself.
So if you see me stuck in the elevator and you see me doing all of that, don't ask, you'll know why. Okay, so that's important. So really what it is certain meridians reaches certain points.
Meridian points.
And what will happen is it'll calm you down, and it definitely works. How many sessions does a person have to do in order to...
It's very individual. Some people, it can work like that in one session, three sessions, six sessions. So it's really kind of...
But does it help usually pretty quickly? Do they feel it?
Yes.
Do they see
it? You feel it immediately.
If you give yourself a rating of 10 being the highest,
that's
the
what
most
we
stress.
Do. Is,
okay.
is
what
before,
would it be?
Yeah. Before you start tapping, we say on a scale of 0 to 10, how upset are you on that? So after one round of this, they're usually down a few points. So you do a few more, and they go down.
You're going to have to come back.
Okay.
Because you have so much.
Thanks,
Gail. May my other guests come on over so we can say goodbye. How fast
it flies. It flies.
Go?
Gail, you're a wonderful host. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Love you, guys. Thank you. Mwah. I can't get up because I've got all the apparatus on me. Okay. Love you. Oh, well, that's our show for tonight. We're just going to blow you a kiss and say, mwah, bye-bye. Hope you had a good time. I had a ball.
It was a blast.
Thank you. So great. I loved it. It's a wrap.